Hey guys, it's Danny. Today we are talking all about slow-release fertilizer and how I use it, what type of slow-release fertilizer I'm using, and so on and so forth. I've started to use this for more than half a year now, almost a year approaching that date, and I do have some thoughts to share with you. I have some results to share with you, and because I got a lot of questions regarding the use of this product, it is time to make a separate video on it. So I'm gonna tell you what I use, where I got it from, how I use it, and why I actually use it. And towards the end, some thoughts on fertilizer. Generally, fertilizer is not a subject that I talk a lot about on my channel, not because I don't know what I'm doing, because I actively chose not to talk about, but I'll address that at the end. So I hope you'll enjoy this video. If you end up enjoying it, do give it a like, and why not subscribe? I post 3 times a week. Right, so with that intro out of the way, let's just start with what I'm using and where I got it from. Oh no, oh, the bag is broken actually. I'll have to be a little careful. So what I'm using is Osmocote Pro High K. I purchased it from Orchids Deluxe, which is a nursery here in the EU, but it only ships within the EU. Usually organics, fertilizers, pesticides generally are only sold in specific economic regions or countries. If I wanted to order this from the USA, it would just be held at the border and probably destroyed. So if by the end of this video you want to test out this product, do search for it in your economic region, because the source that I got it from only ships to the EU. But as you can see, it is not in its original package, and this is because Orchids Deluxe usually sells it in lower quantities. The original package is pretty big, it's a few kilograms, which for typical home growers, it's a little excessive. So I got me quite a lot of it because I have a lot of orchids. And what I like to do is keep this bag in a separate location away from excess humidity and open it as infrequent as possible, due to the fact that, one, the bag can break, and actually I'm gonna replace the bag after this video, and two, typically solid fertilizers are hygroscopic. They attract humidity, and I'm pretty sure the chemical formulation can be altered. So I like to put a small quantity in a jar, which I will open frequently, and keep this one away from humidity as much as possible. You can see that in my jar already some of the beads are sticking to the bottom. That's because they already absorbed a little bit of humidity, but instead of potentially spoiling an entire batch, I only spoil a little bit of it. As far as I can see, Osmocote is actually available in multiple regions, so the best thing to do is to just Google for this product in your economic region. It can be eBay, Amazon, nurseries, even plant nurseries. This is not an orchid-specific fertilizer. It can be used with orchids, but with other houseplants, and maybe even gardens generally. So if you want to try it out, that's the best approach. And if you are in the EU, you can actually visit Orchids Deluxe, although I see it's not in stock anymore. But it used to be in stock for all of last year, I believe, so I think it's gonna come back. Anyway, why do I use slow-release fertilizer? Am I not okay with the MSU, which is my go-to fertilizer? Yes, I am. There are a few inconveniences, or let's say lacks, that I have in my life, which sometimes can result in under-fertilizing my orchids. So the use of slow-release fertilizer is not something that generally everybody should do, but there are circumstances in which it can help. So I'm gonna tell you my circumstances. If you can relate, maybe this will help you. If you cannot relate at all, you don't need this. Actually, you can stick to your normal fertilizer if you found a good one. Now, personally, I use the Osmocote slow release fertilizer at the same time with my MSU powder fertilizer, which I've been using for the past 5 years or so with what I believe to be great results, even though I'm kind of running out of the MSU. Not sure what I'm gonna do after. Anyway, besides the point, this is not a replacement for this. However, there are certain times in my life where I just don't have the time and availability to prepare the MSU fertilizer. This guy needs to be diluted in water, which is simple enough, but I personally need to prepare a lot of liters of water. What I usually do is prepare it in a separate bucket and then pour it in my sprayer or can or whatever I use at that time, and then go about fertilizing the orchids. And I need to let this dissolve for about a minute or two, or maybe even longer, just to be sure that everything is pretty balanced and even. Now, this adds a little bit of effort and a little bit of time to my watering routine, which, again, when you amount the total number of my orchids, can extend my watering time with as much as 40 minutes, to be fully honest. And sometimes I don't have that extra 30 minutes or half an hour. So what happens sometimes, not all the times, but what happens is I end up under fertilizing some of my orchids because I just simply did not have time to prepare fertilized water, and I just wanted to water everybody really fast because they're dehydrating already. There are a gazillion reasons why your life can abruptly just change a little bit, and that change can determine lack of time. It happens. So as much as I thought that I could be on top of fertilizing, sometimes it just didn't happen. So I thought, what can I use to actually help me out a little bit? Because using more fertilizer is not a solution. It's not gonna remain in the pot and be used gradually. It's just gonna be over-fertilization and possibly damaged and burnt roots. Well, I kind of gave away the keyword, slow release. Slow release fertilizers. Have you noticed that some orchids, when you purchase them from the nursery, they have little tiny beads inside the potting medium? Yeah, those are slow release fertilizers. Nurseries, commercial ones, they do use them a lot because they save time. Instead of preparing a fertilizer solution and sprinkling, let's say from above, whatever the irrigation method is with that nursery, rather than wasting time and human power doing that, when you pot the orchid, just put in some slow release beads and then just use your normal water, water the orchids, and that's enough to keep them okay until you sell them. Why can't I do that? And well, it turns out I can. And it turns out it was actually a great idea. So not having time is one of the reasons why I decided to try out using slow release fertilizer as well. Another reason is self-watering pots. These guys don't get watered as often as all my other orchids because they have a reservoir which usually contains some water. And this helps me out a lot with very thirsty orchids or whenever the season is warm, which is pretty much almost all the time here. So there were two things I was worried about. One, if I leave fertilized water for a week or two inside the reservoir, will the chemical formulation remain the same or will it deteriorate in time with the presence of air and, you know, all that chemistry stuff that I'm not really very good at, but I'm trying to educate myself as I go. So what if the fertilizer deteriorates and the nutrients suddenly become unavailable for my plant? Will that induce some deficiency? It might. But this is not all. There is another type of orchid that I have, which most of the times does not get fertilized water. And I shouldn't do that, but I do. Hold on, I need to get her. And this is not a specific orchid, it's an entire group of orchids, the miniatures or the seedlings. Now, as much as I try to make everybody as balanced as possible and try to achieve a sort of schedule with my watering that will benefit everybody, it is just impossible with some orchids. For example, the tiny orchids in tiny pots. They will simply dry out faster than everything else because they're very tiny, and this doesn't actually help. It's a good idea that I need to repot this orchid. Maybe we're gonna repot this one today. So because the pot is so tiny and I cannot really leave a lot of water in the pot, these tiny orchids do actually dry out much, much faster than everything else. It's really, really hard for me to reach a balance with these guys. With stuff like Cattleya's, Oncidiums, even the self-watering orchids, I can balance them pretty easily. Even if the Cattleya's dry out faster than the Oncidiums, they can sit dry for 3 days while the Oncidium reaches that sweet spot where it can actually receive water, since the Oncidium usually has more sphagnum moss. So I do balance them that way. But with these guys, I can't do that because they dry out faster, and because they're tiny, they are at risk of dehydrating faster. They don't have a lot of structures. It's just not a good idea to leave them dry for too long. So am I actually going to prepare 4 liters of MSU just to water 10 orchids, 10 tiny orchids that require maybe 500 milliliters of water? No. I'm not gonna do that because I don't wanna store this. Again, I feel like it's going to deteriorate somewhat in time if I prepare it and store it. Might not be true, I don't know, I just feel that way, and I don't wanna prepare it in advance. So again, what I usually do is use osmosis water for these guys a lot more frequent. And when it's time to actually water everybody else with fertilizer, these guys are already still a little wet, so I don't want to water them. And what happens is I will water them at a later date without fertilizer yet again. And I feel like it shows. I feel like this is not supposed to be this pale, which, you know, it's going to be a good candidate to test out, maybe starting today. So for these guys as well, I thought, wouldn't it be nice to have something inside the medium to provide something while I try to figure out when I should water with these guys with fertilizer and when I have time to prepare it? That'd be neat. So another reason why I wanted to try out the slow release fertilizer. Pretty much that's it. I did not decide to use this because I think it's the greatest fertilizer ever. I think it's pretty good. I looked at what it contains and I think it's good. It's similar to the MSU, reason why I chose it. If you feel like you can use a helping hand, slow release fertilizers can actually do that. If you feel like you're on top of fertilizer, I don't know if this guy will make such a difference for you or will actually give you the help you need. So with that said, let's just look at the first orchids that I used the slow release fertilizer with. And these are these guys. Now, fun fact, last year, I think it was summertime when I repotted them and used the slow release fertilizer, I did film. But guess what? I deleted the footage. So luckily I do have older footage with both of these orchids. So you see how they used to perform in the past. This is 5 or 4 years old in my collection already. So I do have quite a lot of footage and I do think I can see quite the major difference. So this one is the Howeyara. I find this to be quite a finicky orchid until you figure out what it wants. And when you do, it's just gonna grow. So for a lot of years, it bloomed, it performed really, really great. But I will have to agree that the best looking leaves and the best and biggest pseudobulb bulb and the best blooming happened this year. This is the best I got out of it, out of all of these years. And I had it in self-watering before. So the only thing that I changed was adding that slow release fertilizer in the medium. Same with this one. This is the Onocidium Popcorn Haruri. Had this guy in bloom twice already. He performs brilliantly, beautifully. I love him. But again, I will have to agree that this growth, which is not yet mature, but I can tell already, it will be the best growth that it has. Maybe not by a whole lot, maybe not night and day, but definitely it is better. So as far as I can tell, nothing bad is happening. On the contrary, things are actually looking a little bit better. Now, these were still fertilized with my MSU, but again, they're self-watering. I don't fertilize them as often as the other guys, so the presence of the Asthmocoat actually replaces the absence of the MSU. So these are the two oldest orchids that I use the slow release fertilizer on. Currently, I'm adding slow release fertilizer for all of my orchids, but I don't have like results with before and afters to show you except for these two. So we're just gonna take into account these two orchids. Right, so now let me just show you how I use it. I'm gonna repot really, really fast, not very detailed, a little orchid just to show you how I use the fertilizer. All right, so we're actually gonna work with this little orchid, which is looking kind of pale. We're gonna see if there will be any difference in a few months. This is a Maxillaria variabilis that I received from one of you guys. It has quite a nice root system and it grew pretty nice and it's blooming. I just don't like how the leaves look like. So I'm gonna be using the same pot. It did not outgrow it. It's not going to outgrow it anytime soon in the next 2 years. So we're good to go. And I'll be using my typical sphagnum moss and bark mixture. Sphagnum moss at the bottom and then bark everywhere in between. If you don't know anything about this technique, it has to do with the way that I water. I have a video talking at length about it. I'll link it to it down below in the description. So for those of you who know, I guess you know where this is going. I will just continue to add sphagnum moss and bark. Let's position the orchid in the pot. So I will alternate bark and sphagnum moss. In this way, I am achieving the aeration that I want and the water retention that I want. I don't like to pre-mix these media before because I cannot control them. I have some issues with control, as you can see. But that actually pays off, I have to say. I don't have control issues in real life, not that many. But with orchids, I do a lot. Okay, so this is, let's say, the last bark layer, which is internal. It's not the top layer. Next up, we have another sphagnum moss layer, it's not the top layer, it's the second to the top layer, let's put it like that. And it is on this layer that I'm arranging the slow-release fertilizer, because sphagnum moss will always be much, much wetter than bark. And actually, this is designed to work with soils and wet media, not bark. So I like to place it on the uppermost layer, just so when I water, all of the nutrients go down in the pot. So I place, okay, I think I had 5 or 6 beads. I'm gonna talk a little bit about the dosage towards the end. Continue with the top layer of bark, and we're done. So the top layer prevents algae from occurring way too much. And also it maintains humidity for the next layer, which is sphagnum moss, and obviously for the slow release fertilizer. And then it's just watering as normal and fertilizing as normal as often as I can. And that's about it on how I arrange the slow release fertilizer. Now let's talk a little bit about the dosage. On the instructions of the Osmocote, you can see that you can actually use 2 to 3 grams per liter of medium or soil. When I purchased this on Orchis Deluxe for the dosage, they said 1. I actually have a scoop that measures 1 milliliter. So they said 1 per 1 liter of medium. And well, let me just get the scoop. This is a 1 milliliter scoop. I kind of visually saw how much it is. So I visually have a representation of what I should use for 1 liter. Now this is more like 100 milliliters. So obviously I will just need a pinch of this, which is like 5 to 6 beads. And again, for visual representation, 1 liter of medium is something like this. This is a 15 centimeter pot, and around 500 milliliters, which is half a liter, is the standard orchid pot, which is the 13 or 12 centimeter diameter. Now, of course, your product may actually have directions for gallons and ounces, but you know, in Europe, most of the times we are working with liters. If not, you can easily transform them using Google. So having this visual, I kind of know instinctively how much of a pinch I need to use. So for this, I'm gonna use this much, which is about half of this scoop. Let's see. Oh, look at that, spot on. I'm good. I didn't know I was so good. Okay. So visually, I kind of know already how much I use, but obviously if you want to use this, maybe get one of these things. This is from IKEA. I'm sure you can find it at other grocery shops even. So you'll have a better representation maybe for your measuring system, which might not be the same as mine. So I'm not measuring it at the moment, but there are measurements on the market which can help you out. And one more idea before I end today's video. For any type of fertilizer to properly be absorbed by plants and by orchids, you need the medium or environment around the roots to be proper and help with nutrient absorption. And by this I mean, you need it to be adequately moist. If fertilizer dries out, the plant cannot absorb it, it is not available anymore. And 2, you need the pH to be slightly acidic in the vast majority of cases, or for the majority of nutrients. You might already know the saga with the LECA and how alkaline it was, and it was just a mess, and I assure you, it shows. But with bark and sphagnum moss, which naturally have a slightly acidic pH, nutrient absorption is generally optimum without you having to do anything. But when you're going into inorganic materials that alter pH, that's when you might actually need some adjustments, which, you know what, I'm gonna talk about in the next video. This morning, I had the idea to make a sort of Q&A, so I asked you guys to leave me questions related to fertilizer, and you left a lot of great questions. I have some questions prepared as well, but I'm currently editing this video and it's already 18 minutes long or more, which is, it's a little long if I add to the Q&A the way that I want to add it. So I will leave the fertilizer Q&A for next time, for Wednesday. I will tell you what I think about additives, supplements, organic fertilizers, clickbaity banana peel type of fertilizers, All of those things I will address next time. Plus, if you guys have questions, do let me know either in the community section I made a post, either down below in a comment on this video, and I will try to answer as many questions as I can. I like to keep it simple, to be fully honest. It's not a complicated subject. It just deals with a lot of numbers and a lot of abbreviations and a lot of maybe chemical stuff that you don't hear about every day. But it's pretty simple, at least in my opinion. And if you like what you see on my channel, I'm here to tell you all about it if you want to know. So leave me your questions. With that said, thank you so much for watching this video. Hope I managed to clarify whatever questions you might have had about the slow release fertilizer. And maybe in about a year, we can see more results than I showed you today. So with that said, thank you for watching. Hope you have a great day. Subscribe to my channel for more orchid videos, tutorials, experiments, updates, and other fun orchid subjects. If you wish to support the channel, do consider becoming a member or visit the merch store linked down below in the description. You can also follow me on Instagram and Facebook. It's always nice to stay in touch there as well. And I'll see you next time. Bye.